Hello and welcome to this new episode of Free Science 365. Today I'm going to tell you the incredible story of one of my favorite elements, the liquid metal mercury. Mercury has played a very important role in enabling the technological revolution that we have witnessed in this century and in the last century. This video is my effort to explain just that. Mercury's amazing contribution to human technological progress. But given the time limit of 10 to 15 minutes for each video, I'm just going to talk about two watershed moments in human history where Mercury played an integral part. Our first story starts with Evangelista Torricelli, the great Italian physicist, mathematician, and a student of Galileo. After Galileo's death in 1642, Torricelli succeeded him as the chair of mathematics at the University of Pisa. Up until then, Aristotle's 1,700 years old postulate, "Nature abhors a vacuum," was believed to be true by all scientists. Basically, what that means is, if you try to create a vacuum, nature fills it immediately. For example, if you suck air out of this straw pipe, you're trying to create a vacuum where nothing, not even air, exists. But then nature quickly sends the liquid up to fill the vacuum you tried to create. So that's what Aristotle meant by nature abhors a vacuum. Over the next 1,700 years since Aristotle, many people tried to create a permanent vacuum, but nobody succeeded. In 1643, Evangelista Torricelli filled a meter-long tube with one end sealed off with mercury, 13 times denser than water, and set the open end of the tube into a basin of the liquid metal mercury and raised the seal end so that the tube stood vertically. The mercury level in the tube fell until it was about 76 centimeters or 30 inches above the surface of the mercury basin, producing a vacuum above. This was the first ever recorded account of creating a permanent vacuum. Torricelli had not initially intended to create a vacuum. All he wanted to know is why suction pumps fail to pump up water above 10 meters from the ground level. So, instead of water, he chose mercury, which is 13 times denser than water. And his idea was, just like water can be drawn only up to 10 meters above the ground level, in the same way, mercury can only go up 10 meters divided by 13, because mercury's density is 13 times that of water. And that's what exactly happened. But in this whole process, he also created a permanent vacuum. This experimental success of Torricelli led to two great discoveries. First, the barometer, which basically measures the air pressure. The barometer would later play a key role in the development of weather forecasting science. Also, an offshoot of the barometer, the altimeter, would measure altitude and is often used in hiking, climbing, skiing, and aviation. Just imagine how important were these discoveries in the age of exploration. But more important than the invention of barometer was the second discovery of his experiment, that a permanent vacuum can be created anywhere, anytime, by anybody, as long as they have mercury with them. So mercury helped mankind shatter this 1,700-year-old idea of Aristotle that nature abhors a vacuum. And once this idea was shattered, it opened mankind's mind to more ways of creating a permanent vacuum. Now, vacuums played a very, very important role in the development of technology. For example, in the late 19th century, around 1890s, inventors were trying to win the electric bulb war. Thomas Edison was able to win this war because, according to tech historians, among other things, Edison's light bulb had a better vacuum than its rivals. And that led to his dominance of the electric bulb industry. Then, in the early and mid-20th century, the electronic revolution was helped greatly by vacuum tubes. Vacuum tubes became a key component in the electronic circuits of radios, televisions, radars, sound recording and reproduction systems, long-distance telephone networks, and analog, and even the early digital computers. Vacuum tubes played an integral role in making information and communication technologies widespread in a very short period of time. Vacuum tubes created the discipline of electronics. So thanks to Torricelli's vacuum and hence to the liquid metal mercury, in 2002, I got my BTech degree in electronics and communication. The very field that was brought into existence by my favorite element, the liquid metal mercury. So that was the first story of how Mercury played a key role in the development of technology for mankind. Next, let's talk about the second story, which is how Mercury played a key role in the development of electricity, without which the first discovery, i.e. a permanent vacuum, would not be of as much value as it later turned out to be. Our second story starts with Michael Faraday, the son of a poor blacksmith, who could only attend school up to the age of 12. But that didn't stop him from becoming one of the most influential scientists in the history of humankind. Albert Einstein kept a picture of him on his study wall. The SI unit of capacitance, the farad, is named after Michael Faraday. He established the basis of electromagnetic force, one of the four fundamental forces in nature. It was because of his efforts that electricity became practical for use in technology. But how did the son of a poor blacksmith, who could only get an education till the age of 12, manage to get this much fame and respect in the scientific world? It's a fascinating story, and of course, in that story, Mercury plays a key role. So this story starts when Faraday was only 14 years old and he becomes an apprentice to George Ribault, a bookbinder in London. Now, life was very hard as a bookbinding boy, but he was in a very happy place. He was surrounded by books, so in his free time, he would study all the scientific papers and books that he would be binding that were concerned with chemistry and electricity. This job also opened Michael Faraday's doors to the rich class who were the main customers for his skill. One such customer gave him a ticket to the Royal Institution to attend a lecture, but in those days, for a person of Michael Faraday's background, it was next to impossible to get this kind of opportunity. In that sense, Faraday was lucky. He was the right man in the right place at the right time. Anyways, at the young age of 21, Michael Faraday attended that first lecture by Sir Humphrey Davy. In the course of time, he got more tickets to these kind of events, so he ended up attending a lot of these lectures at the Royal Institution as well as the Royal Society, and he absorbed all the knowledge from these lectures by taking notes in as much detail as he could. One day, Faraday sent a 300-page notebook where he had written all his observations and things that he learned during these lectures to Sir Humphrey Davy. The idea was to convince Sir Humphrey Davy to give young Michael Faraday a job at the Royal Institution. Now think about it for a second. Michael Faraday, 21 years of age, a poor blacksmith's son with not much formal education and absolutely no experience in science or laboratory work, asks for a job at the Royal Institution from Sir Humphrey Davy. And in 1813, he actually gets a job in Humphrey Davy's lab. It's like a fairy tale, isn't it? But that's the thing about people of scientific temper and conviction. Great minds, such as Michael Faraday, Albert Einstein, S.N. Bose, are not discouraged by the limitations of their past or present. They are actually excited about the possibilities of the future. Anyways, back to our story. Once Faraday got the job at Humphrey Davy's lab, he worked really, really hard and designed experiments that would change the course of human technological development. Now, one of the most important problems of Michael Faraday's time was that even though scientists understood that electricity affects magnets in strange ways, nobody knew how to control and exploit this phenomenon. But in the autumn of 1821, Michael Faraday devised an amazing experiment with the help of a battery, a few wires, and the liquid metal mercury. Basically, he created a circuit with copper posts and a wire that hung from the copper post and freely dangled into a pool of liquid metal mercury. Now, in the middle of this pool of mercury was placed a permanent magnet. Why mercury? Because one, mercury is a metal, so it would conduct electricity and complete the circuit. And two, because it's liquid, so the wire could move more freely. When the current runs through the circuit, it generates a circular magnetic field. Because remember, electric wires behave as magnets, so this current that runs through the circuit creates a circular magnetic field around the wire. The wire's magnetic field interacts with the magnetic field of the permanent magnet, and as a result of this interaction, the wire would rotate around the magnet in a uniform circular motion. This was, in essence, the first ever electric motor. Faraday was successful to demonstrate the relationship between electricity, magnetism, and motion. Within 10 years, through rigorous trial and error experiments, Faraday was successful in creating electric current by moving a wire around a permanent magnet. So for the first time ever, mankind had unlimited supply of electricity, unlike the batteries in those days, which would exhaust after a certain period of time and were very, very bulky. Today, almost all electricity in the world, including the electricity that comes to your home, office, school, etc., is generated using Faraday's original method of moving a wire around a magnet. So that's the second story of how the humble liquid metal Mercury helped mankind in taming the natural force of electricity. So these were the two stories that I wanted to tell you. Now let's talk about various misconceptions that we have about the liquid metal Mercury. Now, in many cultures, mercury is considered to be a very dangerous element. And to be honest, the toxic nature of mercury vapors is to blame for that. Mercury vapors are extremely dangerous. They can be toxic to our nervous system, lungs, and kidneys. Now, when I was a kid, I'd heard from adults that if you hold liquid mercury in the palm of your hand, it will make a hole in your palm. I also heard that if you swallow the liquid metal mercury, it would make a hole in all your organs across your body, vertically down. So let's address these one by one. First, the story about liquid mercury making a hole in your palm is totally a misconception. Pure elemental mercury can be touched by human hands as long as you have healthy hands and there's no cuts or bruises or wounds in your hands. It's heavy, no doubt, but not heavy enough to actually make a hole in your palm. That's impossible. Now, what about the second one? If you swallow liquid mercury, it will make a hole across your organs and come out the other end. Well, even this is a misconception. If somehow you swallow mercury, it will pass through your digestive tract. Most of it passes through your body, and very little is absorbed inside of your body. This story is also a misconception. But just to be on the safer side, do not attempt to swallow liquid mercury in any situation. If you need to touch or handle mercury for experiments, etc., please make sure you have emergency medical help at hand, and please do so in the presence of someone who is expert in handling mercury. So, that was our video for today. Thank you for watching till the end. If you liked what you watched, please press the like button. If you really liked my video, please consider subscribing, and I'll see you in the next one. Until then, bye-bye.